Yes.
Good morning.
Or good afternoon.
Right.
Good afternoon.
As I understand, there are quite a few applications sort of at least in the air, some lack of clarity as to which are effective.
Yes.
But there is one presumably that has to be taken first if it's still alive, and that's the application to be heard in private.
Yes. That is not going to be procedural at this stage. My friend and I had an opportunity to speak about it, and I've explained the basis of the application, and we are putting that off to another occasion, because the matters shouldn't arise in the context of the discussion that we're going to have before you today. So, an update, please.
All right. Well, I think there's some difficulty in what I call putting off the point. If this is an application that should be heard in private, there is some difficulty in bringing the curtain down halfway through.
Would you mind, excuse me, ma'am? Your Honour, if we have a few minutes with you, I can explain perhaps that in a way that will...
It was simply a warning shot across
yes.
the bows.
Yes.
I confess a degree of difficulty in identifying how, when the matter comes back in some other context for the determination of some different issue, it can then be suggested that the entire hearing should be in private when the earlier hearings have not been. I can see that there may well be then, conceivably, some need to ensure that confidential information is not transmitted outside the court. But that's a quite different point.
Yes. It relates to certain information and the disclosure of certain information. And my friend and I agree that the information concerned doesn't need to be disclosed at this stage. And it is a matter that can be dealt with as and when the meeting.
Well, what I'm saying is, again, I'm having some difficulty in
perhaps
identifying how an application can be not in private one day and then in private the next, simply because there's some confidential information.
It may be easiest if we invite you on to sit in private for a few moments and bring your into the fold, as it were, so that you know what the information is. Because we take the view it's completely irrelevant to any issue in the proceedings so far.
If I need to understand it, perhaps we need to go into chambers, as one might say. But I don't want to waste time on this. I've indicated my initial reaction to the concept of reverting, or not even reverting, bringing a privacy curtain down halfway through a case, but there it is. If that's what you've agreed, can in some way be anticipated, so be it. But it would be a surprising outcome, I'll put it now, other than that.
Your Honour, we hear what you say,
yeah.
And we will take that on advisement.
Okay, well, let's forget that, so nobody has to leave the court. Now what are we on to?
So there were three applications before you. My application to vary, my friend's application for a letter of request
right.
by courts, and then thirdly, my application for disclosure, if
right.
I use shorthand. The letter of request application is one that I do not oppose, and therefore it will be dealt in very short order. There has been a narrowing of issues to some extent on the variation order, and I would hope that we can deal with that in a very short order. And there is perhaps more arguments about the application for disclosure, but I'm confident it can be dealt with relatively briefly at this stage, and therefore the time we have available will be sufficient for all purposes.
Right. So which do you want to take first? The letter of request, you say, is not challenged.
Not challenged.
And what the form of order is agreed?
The We might have overlooked actually drafting an order, but it's a very short order that the court directs a letter of request be issued. The draft letter is before Your Honour.
Yeah, just remind me where it is.
It is in a folder, well, the easiest place to find it is in bundle 4.
Yeah.
And it's behind divider 35.
Behind which?
Divider 35.
This presumably is some template for this, isn't it?
It's a standard template for the attack to the rules of the IFC.
Thank you. And this will be addressed to who?
This will be addressed. I'm sorry. It will be addressed to the Dubai courts, who will identify the precise person in due course.
Well, I think it's probably necessary to. I'm going to have a complete letter before I sign it off, or before certainly before the registrar signs it.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. We wouldn't expect the registrar to issue the letter without it.
Okay. Right, and so you're drafting a form of order.
Yeah.
I think the form of order should identify the addressee with some precision.
Yes.
Okay? Right, well, we'll deal with that when that draft is ready. Thank you. Now, what do you want to do? Variation or disclosure?
Variation.
Okay.
Just because it came first in time. Your Honour, the claimant's document for the skeleton argument goes on a very great length as to the basis of its substantive claim and why it says it has a strong prima facie case against the defendant, such as to justify the freezing order continuing.
Right.
I am not intending to deal with that today because in my submission it's just not relevant, certainly to the variation application. I'm going to keep myself very much to the narrow issues that are in dispute. This is, of course, not an application.
But there's no application to discharge, either this injunction or the London injunction, is that right? And if there's another one in Guernsey?
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, there's an order, of that. Yes, the London is merely a piggyback injunction, if I can call it that, dealing with assets.
So I'm actually clear about this, I'm sorry. Has there been an inter-parties hearing in either of those jurisdictions?
There has been in London.
Yes.
My friends.
And no application to discharge?
No. And there was no challenge in that jurisdiction to the arguability of the case that had been brought by myself.
So the proposition that there is a prima facie case is a common ground?
It is one that isn't disputed.
All right.
That's the way it happened.
Well, the court has accepted it. In London?
Yes, because I didn't seek to challenge it in the same way as I don't.
Yeah. Anyway, well, when was that granted in London?
In the early August.
Yeah, so
13th of August.
So over a month ago.
About a month
ago. All right, thank you.
About a month ago.
Right.
I don't want to, in my submissions, address things that would be relevant to a substantive dispute, although I will have to come back to that in dealing with the application for disclosure.
Yeah, understood.
In due course. It is perhaps worth pointing out that the time for a defence in this action has not yet arisen. As you will have seen from the skeleton argument, my client is currently in custody, where he's been so since May. And no defence is due for him until such times after he is released.
What's the basis for that?
That is the order of the court.
So the order is that he must serve a defence, what, within 14 days of release, or what?
Three weeks of release. It's relevant, by the way, to say that, because my friend's constant refrain will be, well, we haven't served a defence, and we ought to do so. And I mentioned custody because that's relevant to a lot that I have.
Well, as I understand it, your client was going to provide an affidavit with a full defence in support of the application for disclosure. That's what you said.
It has been suggested in correspondence that would happen, yes.
Yes.
It is a very difficult task to get instructions because of the fact that he is in custody and visits to...
Yeah, but presumably that was made on instruction.
It was made with hope that that would be the position, and it hasn't proved possible. Of course, Your Honour, any defence put before this court should be fully and properly particularised. There is no point putting forward a bland document that will merely give rise to a complaint that it is bland, a request for further information, a suggestion that it's specious, and then arguments about what disclosure should be given in light of the breadth of the allegation. And of course, one can see my friend is already lining herself up to say the allegations are far too broad and disclosure shouldn't be given if he pleaded like this as a fishing expedition. I want to avoid that. I want to have a follow-up.
Well, we'll have to come to that. But I mean, what you're asking for is pre-defence disclosure.
That is when we come to that. Yes, I am. And we'll come to that in due course.
Yeah.
For the purposes of the defence, all I want to do at the moment is explain the difficulties that we have in producing a defence with the particularity that should be expected of this court. And in my submission, that the fact that there is none yet cannot realistically and justly be held against my client. If I follow the order of my skeleton argument as to the matters sought to be varied, the first topic is living expenses, and you will have seen, as I said, in paragraph 10 of my skeleton argument, and it's paragraph 64 of Mr. Bodner's rather longer document, that it is agreed that paragraph 9, subparagraph 1 of the order, i.e. the freezing order, and I use it as a defined term, be amended so that the amount for living expenses be changed from $2,050 per month to $250 per week. $2,050. Ever hopeful to increase it. My friend in his skeleton argument makes a point that that doesn't mean that we get a payment of that sum. He's absolutely right, and we don't seek to vary the order in that respect. It makes clear that he can have that, provided he explains the sources. And the question of sources is not a matter that I put forward in the application that I make. The next, or there is an issue between us, in relation to the fact that as it currently states, the order is only effective when the defendant is not in custody. You'll see in the second line, it says that he has the expenses if not in custody. My application is to remove the words if not in custody, and that is resisted. It is unclear from my friend's skeleton argument whether he resists it totally in principle or just in amount. In the defendant's submission, it is unrealistic and unjust to suggest that he has no living expenses ongoing for the time that he remains in custody. And Your Honour, you have the evidence in relation to that, as identified in my skeleton argument. And it consists in two parts. I wasn't going to turn it up unless I need to. It's paragraphs 11 and 12 of my skeleton argument. But to say this, that inevitably there are some expenses that have been incurred for sustenance whilst in prison. And my client refers in particular to his need both for food because of his health condition and for the costs of phone cards so that he can communicate with the outside world and recruit without his lawyers. But also there are living expenses in the wider sense of ongoing costs which are fixed, incurred in respect of life, and examples of that would be such things as mortgage payments. What will you have seen from the evidence referred to in paragraphs 11 and 12 of my skeleton argument is that the expenses that the defendant has in fact incurred are substantially more, or incurs per week, more than the $2,050, which are the sum that he's currently entitled to when not in prison, even in circumstances when he is. And in my submission, at the very least, he should be allowed that amount also for such time as he is in custody in the same way as when he is not. There is then a further issue between us as to the amount to which Mr. Haigh is entitled to per week. The current sum is, as I've said, $2,050, and I seek to raise it to $5,000 a week. The argument, therefore, my lord, is between whether he is entitled to $8,200 a month or $20,000. Now, I've already referred to the evidence as set out in paragraphs 11 and 12 of my skeleton argument, and Your Honour, I hope that you have the opportunity to read the passages of the statements and underlying documents exhibited to that, to which it refers. I accept it could be more complete than it is, but that is the evidence that we're able to get, given the difficulties in communicating and dealing with our clients. As I have said, they show that his ongoing expenses are much more than the $2,050 that the order says that he's entitled to in the field alone whilst in prison. There is a generic complaint of my friend that it's an awful lot of money. My lord, it is not so for a man who, until his incarcerations, was earning a considerable sum of money. And the fact that he was can be seen in Exhibit 11 to the first affidavit served in relation to this, which shows that his earnings from the claimant was in excess of £750,000 per year. You're right, I don't know whether I need to turn that up. It's in Volume 1, Tab 2, and it is at page, you'll forgive me, 83, using the document at the top, where you'll see a letter written by a Desiree Edwards office manager of the claimant saying just that. A salary bonus and stock option package from his role within our group, including Leeds United.
I'm so sorry, you said Bundle 1.
Bundle 1.
Tab so which two. Set of bundles?
Oh, sorry, Stevenson Harvard Bundle.
Yeah. Tab 2,
page 83, using the numbering at the top.
Yes, I have to say that threw me from time to time. Right.
And what I read to you is the second paragraph.
Yes, thank you.
So, you'll see, not surprising that he has ongoing expenses of a fixed nature of a situation.
So, but that's a total of salary, bonus, and stock option.
Yes, including working for Leeds United. Now, it is correct, as my friend says in his skeleton argument, that $5,000 a week wouldn't meet all of the defendant's actual requirements, as stated in our evidence, which is absolutely correct. correct. The application is made on a realistic basis, and therefore the sum sought as permissible expenditure is a conservative amount to at least help alleviate the extreme financial predicament he finds himself in. And it is, in my submission, relevant to note, as I've said in paragraph 12, that it is an amount that he has sought pretty much in the same terms since the outset. And I said that by reference to the email relied upon for a slightly different purpose of my friend in Stevens and Harwood Volume 2. Page 6.
Which, top or bottom?
Top. And Your Honour, going to always be at the top.
Okay.
He said, quickly. You'll see here, and this is an email sent from the defendant's previous lawyers to Gibson and Dunn, and the paragraph that I rely upon is the last full paragraph. He proposes that, and you'll see there that the proposal is at $4,768 per week. And I say that to show.
Let me understand that. I don't know. It's made up. That's made up partly of the mortgage.
Yes. Well, you'll see the
partly of credit cards.
Well, those
and partly of chiller charges, whatever they may be.
I'm assuming that means air conditioning, but I haven't actually.
Air conditioning.
Tell me how we understood it. Yes.
So air conditioning in his apartment, right?
One would assume that it's in relation to Dubai apartment.
So what are we focusing on?
I'm sorry.
What he needs when he's in custody, or he needs when he's not in custody?
It's both. There are certain things that he needs in custody to deal with the fact that.
Can we focus on that? Now you say that, for what it's worth, that he's asked for $5,000. As from
yes.
The early June, right.
Yes, and I so it's merely the consistency of position is the only point that I'm making. As to the what he asks for in custody, I need to go to the exhibits to my first statement for that. And it is exhibit RPC 11, I think. No, it is RPC 9.
So where do you want me to go?
Well, it's if Your Honour wants to see it, it's in Stevens and Harwood, volume 1, and it is in tab 2, and it is on page 79 at the top.
Okay.
Right. I don't take you, Your Honour, as I need to the cover here, but to explain that the defendant has some health issues.
Right.
And that is related to his stomach, and that is explained or the justification for some of the matters.
So, now, this is a schedule prepared by Stevenson Harwood.
Yes, yeah. On instruction, having explained.
On instruction, okay.
And then if you turn over two pages, to page 81, you'll see the ongoing expenses, if you like, outside prison.
Right. Well, even when he's in custody, these are
yes.
The ongoing monthly expenses
yes.
And liabilities. Right.
Yes. So, there I should say monthly, and I don't know how you are on your conversion tables, my lord, but I'm pretty poor on dirhams. But the according to XE.com, the figure of $9,450 for the daily expenses is worth about $2,500. And the figure for the monthly expenditure of $154,000 is approximately $42,000 or £26,000.
Yeah.
So, that considerably more than I see, and I say that because my friend will take pot shots at various items and say they're not necessary. but they are. My client has both residents in Dubai and one in London that have been retained, and obviously has fixed expenses in relation to those, and indeed council tax on the property that he owns in Penzance, which is referred to in the evidence. So there is considerable expenditure, and as a matter of stand, he isn't able to have any expenditure on any of these sites, and that's why we seek a more realistic sum. I don't seek to challenge at this point the fact that paragraph 9.1 of the order says that we have to explain where the funds are going to come from in order to be able to meet the allowances that are permitted. But that's for another day.
Right. Well, I mean, do you want to deal with the points that Mr. Bodnar makes about the items on page 17, which he describes as difficult to justify? I mean, let's take medicine. Why does he need $500 a week on medicine? It's a pretty astonishing sum.
The evidence.
I mean, what's he buying?
I can't give you the
you can't specifics. Tell me.
What I can say is that he's on various medications.
Yeah, but $500 a week, that's $100 a day. Well, you can't tell me. So if you, then food, water and toiletries, another $500. That's slightly more understandable in terms of food, but where's he buying this food from?
It's being bought from outside and being brought into him, as I understand it.
Oh, I see. So he's entitled to buy food from outside.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, that perhaps is more understandable.
As you would have observed, he's being held in custody at a police station.
Yes.
For move to the prison having been unsatisfactory in terms of communication in particular.
But when you say food, I mean, he's just buying groceries, or is he sending out to La Petite Maison?
One
does. Well, I hope that doesn't sound too different, but there is a considerable difference between buying food for, you know, to, in tins and so on for him to eat, and it would be difficult to spend that sort of money on groceries. But if he's sending out, as he may be entitled to, for what I call quality food from the quality supplier,
it isn't a life of luxury, and it isn't haute cuisine.
Well, it's quite a high figure for food and water and toiletries, but perhaps less striking than the medicines.
Yes.
You've got
phone cards.
Medical care, private medical care. Well, how's that coming in? I mean, doctors are coming to prison, are they? I mean, this is on the assumption that he's got his medicines. What else is happening?
There is a doctor in the prison, but he has to go out
Thank
to
you.
Specialists. Your Honor.
What?
He has to go out to specialists, or he's allowed to go out to specialists.
Well, he's allowed out with guards to specialists, is he?
Yes. To Rashid Hospital, where...
I mean, sorry, I forgot to ask you. I mean, he's not here. Why is he not here?
Because he's in custody.
Well, if he can go out to get medical assistance, surely he can come to court.
Apparently, the police, and this is onshore, would not allow it, or will not allow it, I should say.
I'm sorry, say that again?
The police in Dubai, it's onshore, will apparently not allow it. This being a civil court, and it being unrelated to any criminal proceeding.
Okay. Help me a bit about that. You say that he's entitled to request to leave the prison with in custody to go and see a doctor, but not to come to court. Is that really so?
He has to obtain special permission to go for medical purposes, and it's given on that basis.
Well, I've no doubt he would ask for special permission to come to court and have an opportunity, no doubt, to have a consultation with his lawyers.
It would be lovely to be allowed out, but we haven't been so far able.
Is there any evidence in support of that in the documents?
No. There isn't.
But it just makes me slightly surprised, the proposition that he needs 1,000 dirhams a month to attend on doctors when he's apparently barred from coming to court, which seems to be rather more important.
Well, it is, and Your Honour, quite frankly, we would love to have him out so that we could take proper instructions, because
right.
It's hampering
and
that's very much the preparation of the defence. And were it possible to extricate him for even a limited amount of time, it's something that we would seize upon with much, much enthusiasm.
Might have been of some interest to the court if there was some evidence, particularly documentary evidence, in support of the proposition that a request was made for him to come here and it was refused. But a request to attend on a doctor was allowed. It's strange, isn't it? Anyway, there it is.
Well,
you can't help us.
I can't help, Your Honour. There it is, I think, is the answer. It is.
Now, he said next he's lost 30 kilos, which.
Yes, lost a lot of
stone. Heavy stone, or
yes.
In old money. Actually, more than a couple of stones. Four stone.
I think it's fair to say he was rather large when he went in.
Well,
I don't think
he must have been pretty large. And so his clothes are too big for him.
Yes.
Well, he wears normal civilian clothes in there, does he? Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
And then phone cards, well, that's how he communicates with the outside world. You'll see it's the family, and that's how the legal representatives communicate with him.
Well, again, I need some help about that. I mean, he needs phone cards. That presumably is what? A card which you can use to make an outgoing call,
yes.
On a landline,
yes.
Right? But I thought that he could hardly make any outgoing calls because there were so many people using the phone. And he couldn't
yes.
contact his lawyers except for very, very brief, short periods of time.
Yes. So
is he really going to spend $500 a month, a week, on phone cards?
It's in part for his use, and of course he has to, or he finds it useful to move up the queue if he procures cards for adult inmates that they can use them for their purposes.
These are gifts to other inmates,
well,
to jump the queue.
In addition to his own expenses, the answer is different.
Well, I think he might be a bit more frank about it. Okay, that's what you said.
There is the difficulty that in terms of physically being able to see him, all that's been possible are very short visits, I think it's twice a week, which usually last for 5 minutes, and if the lawyers are lucky, they last for a little bit longer. They take place in a common room in the police station, on a table where there are guards.
No, I'm not on that point at the moment, I'm more on the point of what possible use he has for $500 worth of telephone cards per week, when, as I understand it, one of his main complaints is that he's unable to communicate by telephone, or at least on any regular basis.
But he is unable to communicate as he would wish, but such communication as he is able to do with the outside world is in that amount.
Anyway, this is $500 for him alone. He's got another $250 for handing out to others.
Yes.
So that's not the answer, is it? So what is he spending $500 of telephone calls on?
He can make calls, but they're only for short periods of time, so he has to make lots of calls to be able to make any substantial progress in any conversation with anybody.
Well, he's only ringing in Dubai, isn't he?
Well, I would assume he's also ringing his family back
well, maybe
in the UK
his family as well.
His main place of residence was in the UK. Not
then there's laundry, he's sending out laundry, isn't he?
Yes.
Yeah. And reading material, what's that?
Well, reading material.
What? Papers and books and so on.
Yes.
Okay.
I can't be more precise than that. That is my.
I approach that list with a bit of a long spoon. I'll put it higher than that. Right, now that's weekly expenses while incarcerated.
Yes.
And then what?
Then you have the monthly.
On the schedule of ongoing monthly commitments. You say these are payable while incarcerated or not?
Yes.
Yes.
Ongoing monthly commitments and liabilities.
Right. So, well, let's understand this.
So you see the top is to buy.
What about the two credit cards? Well, how is he spending in prison £20,000 a month on credit cards?
Well, I think that refers to debts that he's already
on
cards. What you'll see if you see
he's paying off debts on credit cards.
Yes. If you look at the, and it's Schedule 1.
Well, it's not bills various, it's one bill.
Yes. He has on.
So what is the debt on his credit card?
Well, Schedule 1 figure, Citibank credit card, that's to the draft order, is 125,000 dirhams.
Sorry, what are you looking at?
I'm looking at Schedule 1 to the draft order.
It's just going to be a page, right?
I'm going to, looking at somewhere else, and I will do that. It is at page 99A to 99B.
Or?
In Exhibit 2.
Sorry?
In Exhibit 2 of Volume 1.
Yeah,
sorry, of Stevens and Harwood Volume 1.
Yeah, I've got that.
It's right at the back of Tab 2. And
okay,
it's the schedule of the payments requested from the £200,000 pound sterling figure held. We'll come back to that in due course. So I was reading the penultimate.
So this schedule is of what?
That's a schedule of what he wants to make payment for out of the £200,000 currently held in the Stevenson Harwood client account.
That's what I think that is. This is not an order, it's a draft order.
It's a draft order, yes. It's a draft order.
It's the order you're asking for, is it?
Yes. This is the order I'm asking for. Schedule 1 actually refers to item 7, which is the 200,000. But that is the credit card figure that we have in there.
Oh, I get you. So I see Citibank 125,000. And HSBC?
And you'll see there's the mortgage arrears there of 37,000 euro as well.
I'm not seeing mortgage arrears. Where
I'm on Schedule 1, just above ADCB.
That you say is HSBC, is it?
No, ADCB.
No, I was just asking where the HSBC credit
card is. It isn't there.
Yeah, right.
I have to say, Your Honour, we had understood this schedule to be a schedule of requested one-off payments. And that the table to which my learned friend was referring a few moments ago, the ongoing monthly liabilities, was, as Your Honour understood it, somewhere in the region of £20,000 a month in credit card bills whilst in custody.
You're absolutely right, my friend. The Schedule 1 is one-off payments, but I was merely explaining what the credit card
bills. This is what you want to use the 200,000 for?
Yes, to pay off the credit card bill. Amongst other things. We'll come back to that in due course.
Well, now I'm beginning to understand. So, this has got nothing to do with monthly expenses. This is one-off payments that you want to
Schedule one, yes.
By using the 200,000 in
yes.
the Stevenson Harwood account.
Yes.
Correct?
That's what Schedule
so
one
So we can forget about that.
Yes, you were merely asking
so
about the credit cards.
So let's come back
cards,
to the monthly liabilities.
Yes. All I was
we can forget the credit cards because they're going to be paid off out of the 200,000.
Well, the Citibank one, it appears, yes. But as I said, the amount in table is substantially more than the sum being requested. And therefore, whilst one may say that some of these items are not necessary, are avoidable or shouldn't be made, one can still reach, as a reducible minimum, a figure of $5,000 per week. And as I said, that is not a surprising figure when one considers the income of this gentleman before his incarceration.
As far as one could be. Okay, let's go back to page 81. Mortgage. That's the mortgage on the Dubai property, is it?
Yes.
Which you're asking, and indeed it's agreed, it should be sold.
Yes.
So,
but of course, the mortgage.
Allowing a bit more to outstand on the mortgage doesn't matter very much. Just come out of the proceeds of sale.
Yes.
And that,
what we're trying
that,
to
that
do
be
is
sold
what,
in a couple of months, would it? Yeah.
Well, one would hope so. What we're trying to avoid is a foreclosure and forced sale, which will produce a lower yield than if it was done.
Well, if there's an order of the court to sell it, it's unlikely that the bank is going to intervene and sell it itself. Indeed, it might be in contempt if it tried to do so.
One would hope.
Yes. Then electricity.
Yes. And there are, of course,
yes,
you are looking at the items to preempt a comment. Long-term contracts that one would have to pay things that don't cease to exist just because one...
But whilst he's in custody, he doesn't need TV and all that.
Well, as I said, there are long-term commitments that one makes by way of a contract, and
you know,
Your Honour, that people can't just walk away from contracts without incurring penalty payments.
Yeah.
And therefore, of course, he's not watching his TV in his apartment in Dubai whilst he's in prison, but that doesn't mean that his contract...
So
which
property are we talking about? It says council tax.
The,
are we talking about London?
Sorry, you're in the London Formal? Section. You're in the
oh,
UK
I see,
section.
You go from Dubai, I follow.
Yes,
so
Dubai is the first four entries, and then you're going to London. And as I've said, the defendant's main place of residency was in the UK, not least because of the work he was doing for the claimant in relation to Leeds United Football Club. And therefore, he has living expenses on two vacations.
I think he can probably live without his gym membership.
Well, that goes back to my point about long-term contracts.
What's the gym going to do? Sue for the bums. Salary and travel. Oh, that's the PA. That's the biggest, almost the biggest item of all. PR media. What's that?
He has been using media and PR agents. I don't push that one very heavily in current context.
Well, I think that must be. Company registration. And secretary. What's that?
I can't understand. There is no evidence.
I mean,
you're not, this is my evidence. I haven't got anything.
Well, all I'm trying to indicate is, perhaps this was a pretty long spoon.
Your Honour, it's the second spoon. I've noticed the cutlery drawer is becoming full. But that is the evidence that I have and put before. As I said...
Where did the 2,000 figure come from?
2,000?
The present allowance.
It came by agreement.
It came by agreement
on this basis. The defendant put forward mortgage payments, chiller costs, and I think one other item. We didn't believe, we didn't necessarily wish to agree it. It's page, it's the Gibson Dunn bundles, divide volume 3, divider 30, page 979.
Volume 30, yeah, divider 30, page.
979.
Oh, sorry, we looked at this a bit earlier
yes,
in another version.
That's where the two that amount equates to $2,050 a week.
I'm sorry, you've slightly lost me. The question I ask is, where does the 2,000 come from? You said it was an agreed figure.
Page 983.
I'm looking at page 979.
Yes, if you're on the terms to page 983.
Oh, 983, okay. So in response to that analysis of his requirements.
Yes. The request was then made for $5,000.
Asked for $5,000.
Then, alternatively, 2,000.
2,050, yes.
Yes.
And at least as an interim measure, rather than have a lengthy argument and needed to return to court, we simply inserted that figure.
So you accepted that figure, and that's what went in the order?
If he was, yes, so long as he was not in custody.
Yes, okay. Well, there it is, so far as it goes. Right.
Well, I was going to move on to the Dubai apartment, if I may.
Sorry, now you're moving on to...
The Dubai apartment. The
yeah, just hang on a moment, would you? So if he's got all these expenses, why is he only asking for 5,000?
Because he's trying to be realistic, Your Honour.
In what sense being realistic?
Well, in the sense that there has to be a figure that's both attractive to this court and to which my friend can't take too serious an objection, and therefore...
Well, then how's he going to pay these sums?
He is in difficulty and has to beg forbearance from various people until such time as he can remedy his current predicament.
I mean, the big items here, the mortgage, the payment to the partner, the PA, and PR, that's maybe 50% of these items, yes. All of them look somewhat doubtful to me. Okay. Anyway, you want to move on now to the sale of the apartment,
which
to which there is, I understand, no objection.
There is no objection in principle, is the way that it's put.
Right.
I've been discussing this with my
friend,
and I'm not quite sure where we are. I think that we're in agreement, bar one point about the search order.
Well, that's really a preliminary point, isn't it?
Well,
you can't start the sale until there's been a search, if there is to be a search.
Yeah. There is.
I mean, presumably that the apartment is full of stuff.
I think full is an overstatement. It has stuff in it, and the reason for that is, as I've said, the defendant's primary place of residence was in England, had been for a long time. So it's not as full as one would expect of a primary residence.
Well, I mean, it must have furniture.
It must have furniture, yes, but I don't think it's
bedding and
full to the brim with personal possessions. Not
it must have personal possessions.
Yes. Well, to some extent, but as I've said, his main residency was in England, so it does have things in it, yes.
So what is the position about the search order?
Well, the position is quite simply this, that we wrote some time ago, and I can turn up the date, asking what jurisdiction there was to undertake a search on shore, which is where this apartment is. And we made clear our position that we would consent to the search pending the answer to that question. And that question has never been answered. And so matters are basically at a halt.
Has been a challenge to the search order.
No, there hasn't been a challenge. It hasn't been appealed. It hasn't been allowed to be set aside.
Right.
The order that says, I didn't have the page. It's in. Perhaps look at it. I am looking in. I think it's my friend bundle 2, tab 11. And it's bottom. Number 647. You see the order. Defendant must permit the following persons, the search party, to enter the premises mentioned so that they can search, etc., etc.
So all that's happened is that a letter has been written in response to that by those currently instructed by the federal, asking what jurisdiction there is to execute a search order on shore, and that is one to which no reply has ever been received. And so neither side have moved the matter forward. It's as simple as that.
Well, presumably they're saying, well, if you want to sell the flat, you have to let us in to look.
Well, presumably they will say that, and it's obviously a matter that needs to be resolved. I can't resolve it.
Well, the only way you'll get resolved is make an application to the court that challenges the search order. They may be in a slight difficulty of making an application to the Dubai courts to enforce the search order, I don't know. But there's a standoff at the moment. Your client wants to avoid foreclosure. He wants to sell this and get some money in, which may or may not return to his benefit. I don't know. So on the face of it, it may be said by the other side, well, if you want,
may I have instructions very briefly on my part, which I think are factual.
And if there's nothing there, I can't think it matters very much.
I'm trying to cut through.
Yeah.
The way out of it, I don't have instructions on that point, particularly now because of lack of access to my client.
Right.
But the way it can be dealt is by saying, upon the defendant committing X, Y, and Z, there'll be an order for sale.
Yeah, I think that's true.
I put that forward as a...
Well, it sounds as if that may well be a total waste of time from the claimant's point of view. I don't know if you're right, that all it's got is some furniture in it.
Yes, it may well be.
Yeah, well, they lay their suspicions, no doubt.
Yes, well, it may be why they haven't pursued it with any big.
Quite.
Yes.
Anyway, so subject to that condition.
Subject to that, it's agreed that
you're
the money,
agreed what? That there should be.
The proceeds should go into court. That it should be, and I understand this to be agreed now, that it should be marketed by a reputable agent and the conveyance done by an independent lawyer to be agreed between the parties,
right,
and that both persons be put on notice of the freezing order.
Right.
And I understand that my friend accepts both of those.
So where will the money go?
It will be paid into court. And we will, of course, provide, when we can, an updated figure for the mortgage so that it can be shown that what is paid into court is the net proceeds.
Is the equity. Yeah, yes, I understand. And, well, the car doesn't, you know, it's probably worth a few pounds, I'm no doubt. So what
every little helps, but
you'll
yes.
Do again, go to a reputable Lexus dealer, will you?
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, there's been no discussion in that regard, it's just been said that the sale can be done. Obviously, we want to maximise the proceeds of sale, and therefore we'll...
Anyway, you understand there's really no problem about that?
I understand there's been no problem at all with the Lexus. Okay. There we are. So that leads in relation to the £200,000,
yes,
where it can be spent. There is an issue that's raised that I don't think that we need to deal with, and I'll look at my friend in that regard, about whether the claimant has a proprietary interest to those monies. Very interesting legal question.
Well, as I understand it, he contends it's arguable they do.
Yes,
are you challenging that?
I challenge that it is a proprietary interest. To give you a snapshot of the answer or the position, is that there was a loan made to Leeds United Football Club.
Well, I don't want to get into this unless I have to decide this point. But are you saying that he has no good arguable case that there was a proprietary interest in the 200,000.
The proprietary, no. He has an equitable claim.
I'm sorry,
to it.
Let me put the question again, make sure I've got a clear answer. Are you saying, Mr. Bodnar's submission, that his clients have a proprietary interest in the 200,000 is not arguable?
I say that, but I don't think it matters.
But do I have to decide that?
I don't think so, because of the discussion that we've had, which I hope I will faithfully reflect now.
Right.
It's a nice, interesting question, but I don't think one we need to deal with. In that, the £200,000 was paid in the, from which came by a few firms of solicitors,
yeah.
Stevens and Harwood, Mishkondarea being the first recipient, from a third party, and there's no dispute about that. Is being currently held in Stevens and Harwood's current account on the undertaking that it may be used for the purposes of legal expenses, provided there is an agreement as to the expenses concerned. I paraphrase, but that's it.
So it's the parties are now agreed that £200,000
can
remain with Stevenson and Harwood and can be used for legal expenses in respect of which the bills or invoices what would be presented to the claimant solicitors for agreement.
I don't know whether the word agreement is
for
that.
Review.
What my friend has asked is that the invoices be provided to them, and I understand his position to be that provided that those invoices are provided to him,
yes,
and that they show expenditure of £200,000 or more,
rather than my friend looking across and reciting my position, perhaps it would assist if I simply set out what the claimant's stance is in relation to £200,000. We were asked for agreement that £200,000 of money, which was repaid in the form of a loan repayment, a loan to Leeds United, could be used, or could be transferred to Stevenson Harwood for use in accordance with for leak expenses and disbursements in these proceedings.
I thought they were asking for it to be paid on all a great number of different...
Well, that's the...
But that's history.
That appears to be history.
Right.
The undertaking was that the money would be held by Stevenson Harwood on account and would be used only for the purpose of meeting legal expenses,
right,
which would be agreed, such agreement not to be unreasonably withheld.
Now, legal expenses anywhere in the world, or...?
The undertaking wasn't restricted.
Right.
Our position is this. We make a proprietary claim. Your Honour has seen how we put it.
Yeah.
I don't need to get beyond the good argument level of this here.
Right.
However, in order to progress this matter and to avoid Mr. Haigh saying I have no access to lawyers or liberty or anything, we have made £200,000 available.
Yes, I understood that from your scholarship. Yeah.
We do not expect be making any further money available until the matters which I have, which I intend to address Your Honour on, are addressed. And if that money has been used for things which have not progressed the litigation, well, that's too bad for the defendant. He made a choice. So we agreed money could be used for legal expenses. It would be wrong of me now to stand up and say we've changed our minds.
No.
We are concerned about how quickly this level of fees has been incurred. We are also concerned that what we received was not a breakdown of expenses in connection with this litigation, but two items of legal expenditure, certain experts' reports, and a request that the balance of the funds be used to meet personal expenditure of the defendant.
Yes,
that
I understood your point about that. You're saying that it can only be used for legal expenses.
Quite.
And well, if it's already been used, then it must be, in a sense, credited to that.
Yes. Well,
even if it's been used.
The defendant and his lawyers, how they make use of that money, will release it. We will be submitting. There's no reason to be releasing any more for it until certain events have occurred. And if the defendant is in a weak position, for example, in relation to the evidence before Your Honour, as to his assets and his expenditure, well, he's had £200,000 made available to him to ensure he wasn't in such a weak position, and Your Honour should have no sympathy. So that is our position. And if the position now, notwithstanding the draft order, is that schedule attached to which my late friend took Your Honour a few moments ago, can be jettisoned, and the money...
Well, that's what I understood.
Then there is lack of relationship between us.
Right.
The position is, to be clear, that so far the £200,000 hasn't been used at all.
Right.
It's just sitting in the account.
Right.
Because the two sides haven't been able to come to terms.
Right.
My friend's been asking for invoices, and we've been reluctant to provide information because we think that the matters are privileged. And
right.
We should do that. That is where the problem has raised. I understand the lockdown to have been broken to
yeah.
the extent that my friend is content that I do spend that money, provided I spend it on legal expenses.
Right.
And
I mean, how much has it been incurred so far?
In excess of £200,000. You've got to understand that we're fighting in four different jurisdictions.
Well, I follow that, but in effect, the money's gone.
Yes, this will.
It's been already subsumed by legal expenses incurred today.
There are intended destinations for it in relation to costs that have already been incurred. Yes.
Legal costs. Yeah.
Yes, legal costs.
So what your instruction? Sorry, the claimants. You will tell the claimants instructing solicitors what sum is being paid for what? Will you?
We are prepared to give them the invoices that we will be discharging with them.
Right.
I think the invoices, but not the narratives supporting.
Well, because it might disclose privileged information.
Yes. And we have copies for you, as you said, in correspondence. We're quite happy to share it to you.
I'm not happy to look at something they can't look at.
It's not something you need to look at.
Well, to some extent, I have to rely upon Mrs. Stevenson Harwood. Not to divert this money for a purpose which is, even if it's already been incurred, i.e., if the money has actually been used for some purpose.
The money has not been used. It's been. Lumber letters have been incurred, that the money is still sitting.
Right, well, that's that from your point of view.
So that cuts through the question of proprietary, if we use it in that way.
Right.
So, and that takes me to the end of my application to vary.
Thank you.
And leaves us with the disclosure, which perhaps should be dealt with when we cover
my family. Perhaps we could try and deal with this first. Yes. Yes, Mr.
Yes. So, Your Honour has seen a very long skeleton. I apologise for the length, but it does have the merit that Your Honour has seen precisely how we put the case, and
right.
I have been able to summarise, I hope, a large volume of material in a, I hope, readily digestible.
No, I'm very grateful to you. Thank
you. My learned friend doesn't challenge the proposition that we have written a good arguable case.
Right.
Although he says it's, he said, he doesn't challenge that we have an equitable claim, he challenges whether we have a proprietary claim.
Right.
There's a nice distinction between common law tracing and equitable tracing, but in terms of whether we have a proprietary interest, whether it be legal or equitable, it's a distinction we say without a difference. And I've set out three possible bases on which we do, which we say we do have a proprietary
interest. Well, I'm not going to decide that point.
No. But in our submission, the strength of the case and the fact that there is at the very least a possibility that we're talking about our money should influence everything that Your Honour is asked to decide.
Yeah.
That must be the starting point.
Yeah.
The second thing that should influence Your Honour is that Mr. Haigh has had some 4 months to set out, at least in outline, his answer to this case. As Your Honour noted, everyone was informed that a disclosure application would be made supported by an affidavit from Mr. Haigh, setting out in full the nature of his defence. A disclosure application has been made. It's not supported by any evidence from Mr. Haigh, much less an affidavit setting out in full the nature of his defence. And Your Honour has seen in my skeleton argument the history of what we say has been somewhat evasive information provided by Mr. Haigh. Can I take Your Honour to a document which is a late addition to the Gibson Dunn bundle? It is volume 5. Volume 41, essentially the back of the bundle.
Yeah.
This is a written statement from Mr. Plumtree of Gibson Dunn, who exhibits two documents. And if I could invite you on to turn to page 1672.
Yeah.
Your Honour sees there an unsigned, but we understand approved, witness statement, approved by a Gemma Louise Martel Welsh, we believe on the 6th of June. This is a statement made in the company's court in London. And it was in support of the application which led to the payment of £950,000 from a third party to Michelin de Rey and to Guy's solicitors, £200,000 of which is now in Stevenson Harwood's client account. This witness statement, paragraph 16 of it, 1674, page number. It's Martel Welsh, who is not part of the legal team, says, and this is early June, it has not been possible in light of the arrest of by the authorities in Dubai of Mr. Haigh to obtain information from him concerning the allegations against him or to obtain access to his bank statements to show the source of funding of the loans. We've done that in part because you're on a senior schedule that we've prepared, which shows quite clearly that some £480,000 of the money used to make the loan to Leeds United most certainly was our money, because it went direct from the cooperative bank accounts. I have, however, maintained contact with Mr. Haigh for short periods since Friday the 23rd of May. So he's able to speak people as he chooses. And during our conversations, Mr. Haigh has confirmed that. And then Your Honour sees various matters. Paragraph 16.4, he does not have any interest in bank accounts held with NatWest Putney or Cooperative Manchester. That appears to be the instructions that Mr. Haigh gave to Ms. Martel Welsh. Now, Your Honour asked about company secretarial services. Ms. Martel Welsh is director of Fiduciary Services Company in Geneva, which has subsidiaries in Nevis, which in turn own the Guernsey Company, small capital, through which Mr. Haigh made the loan to Leeds United and to which the £950,000 has nominally been repaid. And so it appears that Mr. Haigh, even at the very outset, simply denied having any involvement in the events which gave rise to the claim. You're only seeing the skeleton argument. His second position was he couldn't recall whether he owned the bank accounts or not. But that if he did, and any money was inadvertently paid into his bank accounts, then he accepted it failed to be repaid. No actual offer has been made to that effect. His current position, so far as it can be discerned from his witness statement, appears to be that he was fully entitled, that he knew about the money going into his bank accounts, and he was fully entitled to it. So the fact that his defence has been evolving from a bare denial of any involvement to the admittedly still only very general indication that he may have been involved, but it was legitimate, no indication of how it comes about that money was paid into his accounts with false references. There's another factor that Your Honour should take into account in deciding whether variation should be permitted to expend what we say will turn out to be our money. Your Honour has seen the so-called disclosure made by Mr. Haigh, paragraph 29 of his witness statement. That was a document 4 months in the making. It was a document which Mr. Haigh was ordered to serve and file as soon as reasonably practical whilst he was detained. It's dated the 4th of September, the same day on which he applied to this court for authority to spend £200,000, 1.2 million dirhams, of what we say is our money, immediately, and $5,000 per week going forwards. A skeleton argument has set out a number of concerns that we have in relation to whether that disclosure is accurate. But before turning to that, Your Honour will have noted not a single detail, not a single supporting document. Not a single thing that couldn't have been provided if Mr. Haigh was so minded. Several weeks ago, at the very least, it wouldn't have taken very long to take the instructions necessary to compile that list, even if Mr. Haigh may have had to have inserted somebody else's phone card more than once to give those instructions. But the explanations provided are either totally absent or appear to be false. We know Mr. Haigh received £600,000 towards the end of February of this year. We know this because there's an email exhibited to Mr. Plumtree's witness statement. It's the first document confirming £600,000 payment to be made to Mr. Haigh's bank. Even allowing for the expenditure which he says he has, even if that had been met in full for the entirety of the period between the receipt of that money and his arrest, and what appears to have been the de facto freezing of his banking accounts by the banks, and since then the actual freezing of his account by order of this court, it still wouldn't begin to reach the level. Not a word about where that money has gone. The account into which it was paid, if Mr. Haigh's disclosure is accurate, has no more than, I think, £17,000 in it. Not a word. The one instance where there is a clear explanation offered is that £57,000 of what we say was our money was paid into his flatmate's bank account and paid out again. The explanation offered is that that money was in fact paid at the direction of Mr. Haigh and was used to meet the costs of rent, which my clients had agreed to meet. The document trail is listed in my skeleton argument. I don't go to it unless I am asked to. What is said is that £57,000 was paid in and £57,000 was used to meet the rent. What we are able to show is that GFH paid £49,000 in rent for Mr. Haigh about 5 months after this payment was made. The payment reference, and it was a payment out of Gibbs & Gunn's client, was Project Raphael. The recipient is named Raphael. The payment reference out has a reference Raphael. The estate agent, who was Knight Frank, asked for the payment to be made, payment reference Knight Frank client account, and for the reference to be paid, so they could marry it with their tenant. So it appears that that single explanation is quite simply false. Where that money has gone, we know not. As for the balance, and Your Honour has seen from the schedule, if one strips out money from the Co-op Guernsey account, the sum in the region of £1.9 million deposited into various accounts. Not explained. £1.2 million, I believe it is, just over, deposited into Mr. Haigh's HSBC account or accounts. That would be in addition to the £600,000 deposited at the end of February. What a word of where that money has gone. So, Your Honour can be quite satisfied that Mr. Haigh has so far failed to comply with the order of Sir John Chadwick, and that he's had a reasonable, more than a reasonable opportunity to do so. In fairness, the defendant doesn't appear to hide what he's doing. He's simply, it's said in Mr. Chadwick's second witness statement, This witness statement was put before the court because if it hadn't been, we would have said he's made no disclosure whatsoever. So he's only chosen to go on record at all because he no doubt realised that if he didn't say anything at all, this court would give him short shrift in asking to spend what may be our money. Now that, in my submission, is the background against which Your Honour considers the expenditure of £200,000 and a request for $5,000 a week going forwards. Even without a proprietary claim, we would submit, in the circumstances, we would be quite entitled to say Mr. Haigh should draw on the resources which it appears he had until very recently, and which remain wholly unaccounted for. And Your Honour knows, on one view of the law, we would be entitled to take that position, even as regards legal views, and to say not one penny to Mr. Haigh. But we haven't taken that approach. We've been pragmatic. But what we can say is this: we made £200,000 available for the purpose of legal fees. We expected that with £200,000 available, the defendant would be able, at the very least, to give proper disclosure of his assets and set out, at least in general, the nature of his defence. But when I say in general, I mean with sufficient particularity for the court to understand what it is that is being said on his by him. What possible answer he has. But that hasn't happened. Now, I would like the claimant's position to be quite clear, lest it be becoming a seal again. We have agreed £200,000. If that £200,000 has been applied to obtaining experts' reports, indeed there's some indication that the claimant intends to retain PwC to conduct an audit of my client, in instructing leading counsel to attend in London to not resist the making of a freezing order in London, and in generally fishing for some form of a defence for this man. Well, that in my submission is too bad for Mr. Haigh. That is how he's chosen to use his money. However, Your Honour may think it's rather telling that with £200,000 one has invoices for experts, but barely a word from Mr. Haigh himself. So that's it, and we would have said, had the application been pursued in relation to personal expenses, that we do have a proprietary claim. Mr. Haigh has failed to make proper disclosure. We should not be required to meet those expenses from our funds. That, in my submission, also informs the position going forward. We have. You're not seeing the reference in my skeleton argument to Fitzgerald and Williams.
Sorry, seeing what?
The reference in my skeleton argument to Fitzgerald and Williams.
Yes.
Well, no, it's a well-settled principle. Until a defendant establishes that he doesn't have anything else available to meet his expenses, he should not be allowed to use what may turn out to be the claimant's money. And that, in my submission, is a starting point. But in any event, as Your Honour has observed, what it is sought to spend the money on beggars belief. Makes no sense. And appears to give the impression of a man almost living in a hotel rather than a police station. It is worth bearing in mind that although only a small amount is asked for per week in clothing, I think it equates to something of the order of £4,000 a year for a clothing allowance for a man in custody. Your Honour has indicated that you approach both lists with a very long spoon, and I submission rightly so. So, in my submission, there is nothing between the parties as to whether Stevenson Harwood can apply £200,000 to legal expenses. But we do say it is remarkable that it has produced what it has produced. We are concerned with the speed with which it has been expended. If the bills are in fact far in excess of £200,000, which have legal implication. But we'd say very firmly, not one penny more, until Mr. Haigh explains himself properly. And so far as living expenses are concerned, we simply say not one penny until Mr. Haigh explains his asset position. And even once he does, proper explanations for the expenditure that he seeks to make. So, unless I can... excuse my back. Unless I can assist you.
No, that's not the thing. Shall we finish, or would you like a break? What would suit you?
I'm entirely in your hands. I wasn't going to say any reference to the application to vary, because it would be repetition. If that's all my friend.
That is all on the variation. Is that?
I think
that's it. So what we're left with is the disclosure application.
Yep.
Okay, well, I think what I'll do,
I'll give a short judgment on the variation issue, and then we'll take a break if we may, and we'll then come back and deal with if it raises the disclosure application. This is an application by the defendant, David Lawrence Haigh, for a variation of a freezing order that was granted by the Deputy Chief Justice, Sir John Chadwick, against him at the instigation of the claimant, GFH Capital Limited. There is no application to set aside that freezing order, either here or in London, where a similar order has been made by a judge of the Commercial Court. The primary outstanding issue that is raised by the defendant relates to the amount of money which the existing order permits him to spend on personal expenses during the course of the currency of the freezing order. The situation is slightly unusual in that Mr. Haigh is in custody and, as I understand it, will remain in custody for a considerable period of time unless there are some significant changes of circumstance. The fact that Mr. Haigh is in custody may explain why he is not here to assist his solicitors and counsel in hearing of this application. I say may explain that because, as I understand it, he has from time to time left to the police station where he has been held in custody, no doubt in the company of police officers, for the purposes of attending upon doctors and medical staff in relation to ongoing treatment for a stomach-related illness. I confess some degree of surprise that if he was permitted to do that, he was, as I am told by the representatives of the defendant, not allowed to come to this court. The fact that he isn't here is not only unfortunate in that he is unable to assist the court with regard to the issues with which it's immediately faced, but it would perhaps overcome the problem which is advanced persistently by the defendant's representatives, that they have difficulty in obtaining instructions from their client, given his position, his situation as being in custody, and not readily available, save for short periods of time, and not easy to contact by telephone. Now, the sum of money which is presently permitted as, quotes, living expenses, close quotes, under the terms of the order, is the sum of, in United States dollars, of $2,050 per week. This figure appears to have been put forward as an alternative by Mr. Haigh or his representatives to the original request for some dollars, $5,000 per week. Having been put forward as an alternative, it appears to have been accepted by the claimant, and that is how that figure comes to be present in the form of order. Despite that apparent agreement, now the defendant asserts that figure is
very much too little. He seeks an order to increase the figure to United States dollars 5,000 per week against the background of asserting that his actual living expenses are almost an order of magnitude greater than that. At the heart of the application are two schedules prepared by his solicitors. One, to identify what have been said to be his weekly expenses while incarcerated, and the other, to identify what are said to be his ongoing monthly commitments and liabilities, both whilst incarcerated and otherwise. These schedules are somewhat eyebrow-raising. For the sake of example, the weekly expenses are said to be attributable to the purchase of medicine amounts to no less than $500 a week, or very nearly $100 a day, and that's said to be attributable to purchase medicines in the form of protein, vitamins, and supplements. Secondly, a similar figure is advanced for the purchase of food, water, and toiletries. No doubt, some money has to be expended on medicine and the basic necessities of life in the form of food and water, but those figures cry out for some justification. There is then a figure in respect of ongoing treatment in the form of visiting outside doctors and medical staff in the sum of $250 a week. I've already made my observation that it's slightly surprising if he's permitted to go out to see doctors, he's not permitted to come to court. But there it is. One can assume that some expenses of a medical kind will no doubt be incurred. And it's then said that he's lost no less than 4 stone while incarcerated and therefore needs to buy further clothes or new clothes for which he wishes to have something like $150 a week. Then there is a very strange item, phone cards. In order to make calls to family members and legal representatives, he wishes to have no less than $500 worth a week of phone cards. This despite the fact that both he and those acting for him insist that there are the greatest difficulties in making use of the telephone in the police station. Even if he was had his own personal landline there, stretches the imagination somewhat that he would incur $5,000 worth of $500 worth of calls to legal representatives in Dubai, even allowing for additional costs of calling family members in other jurisdictions. At one stage, it was suggested that the reason why the figure was so high is because some of the cards would be allocated to other inmates so that he would get priority on the phone. But that doesn't work because he adds another claim for $250 a week to purchase phone cards for other people. He spends, it said, 250 dirhams on laundry and 700 dirhams on books for each week. The total that's advanced is the sum of 9,250 dirhams, which is equivalent to about 2,500 United States dollars. I'm bound to say that my reaction is that I'm wholly unpersuaded that the weekly expenses that he is incurring while incarcerated are anything like as much as that. There is then a schedule of ongoing monthly commitments and liabilities, which
stretches the imagination almost to breaking point. There is a claim in respect of the mortgage on his property in Dubai, but that property he has agreed should be sold, and one cannot help feeling that those monthly commitments will terminate very soon, and if in the meantime there is a failure to pay a mortgage instalment, that is unlikely to be of any significance. Indeed, one of the schedules that he's produced demonstrates that he already has failed to pay 37,000 dirhams worth of mortgage payments, i.e. 2 months' worth. He then makes claims as if the property was still occupied in respect of electricity, TV and cleaners. And then he turns to the United Kingdom and puts forward a range of expenses, including £1,000 a month on the telephone, £500 a month on electricity, water and heating, £3,000 a month for payments to a partner, nearly about $10,000 a month, quotes PR stroke media, $30,000 dirhams a month for a PA, for salary and travel, £1,000 a month for gym membership. One can go on. On top of which, despite the fact that one of them is already massively overdrawn, he is suggesting he wants to spend £2,000 a month on his two credit cards, despite the fact he is in custody. Mr. Godmar, who appears for the claimants, who has produced an elaborate and helpful skeleton argument, which spells out in some detail the background to this case and the extent to which the claimants feel justified in asserting with some confidence that Mr. Haigh has been guilty of serious fraud, and in respect to which there is no challenge that they have a good prima facie case, says correctly that where, as here, the claimants justifiably advance an assertion that Mr. Haigh, the defendant, has effectively stolen their money, and that they are in a position to trace it or treat the money or its equivalent as having a proprietary interest in it, is a circumstance in which the court should be very careful before allowing the defendant to spend money which is in effect the payments. That point, in my judgment, is well made. It may be that there are more elaborate and helpful explanations for some of the figures that have been put before the court, but I confess that Mr. Haigh, despite the difficulties of communication with his sister, has taken a considerable time to say very little about his circumstance, let alone about the complaints that are being made against him. The court would need to be persuaded that the figure that is presently available to him as permissible living expenses is clearly too low. The burden is on him to satisfy the court that it is clearly too low, and needs, at least on his case, to be more than doubled. I confess I'm wholly unpersuaded that the existing allowance of $2,050 per week is inappropriate, certainly while Mr. Haigh is in custody. no doubt the defendant, when he emerges from custody, can, if he thinks appropriate, come back to the court and ask for a higher figure. If he does, he will need to produce more convincing material than he has so far. So I refuse the application to vary the freezing order,
Your Honor,
to increase the living expenses.
May I just make a point to some assistance here? He doesn't get the $2,050 whilst he's in custody. You need to deal with that point. The way you've just spoken suggests...
I'm so sorry. The presently it's $2,050 per week.
When he is not in custody.
You're quite right. Let me rephrase what I've just said. The present order is that he is entitled, when not in custody, to expend living expenses in the region of $2,050 per week. I am not persuaded on the material presently available that if and when he emerges from custody, that is a figure which is inappropriate. If he wishes to come back to the court in due course to challenge that figure, he will need to produce much more convincing material in respect of his living expenses incurred whilst at a free man. The only outstanding question is whether some allowance should be accorded to him in respect of expenses incurred whilst in custody. The defendant puts the court in a very difficult position. The court accepts that some expenses will be incurred of a personal character whilst in custody, including, no doubt, some payments for food and medicine and for phone cards, and it may be one or two other items, such as laundry, reading materials, and so on. I've already said that I regard the weekly expenses schedule while incarcerated as wholly incredible. I effectively are left in the unhappy position of simply having to plump for a figure which is a fair figure whilst he's incarcerated. And I've come to the conclusion that a fair figure while he's incarcerated is $500 a week. So to that extent, I vary the order, the freezing order in respect of living expenses. There is, as I understand it, effectively an agreement in respect of sale of the flat against an undertaking that some opportunity for a search should be open to the claimants, and that thereafter the flat should be put in the hands of a reputable estate agent and a conveyance handled by a reputable independent lawyer, and that the monies subject to the mortgage be paid into court. Similarly, there's an agreement about the defendant's car, the Lexus 4x4. Lastly, there was an application to use a figure of £200,000 held in the defendant's solicitor's client account. I won't go into the history of where that money comes from. The claimant, recognizing perhaps the reality of ensuring that the defendant has some legal representation, despite the fact of claiming that it has a proprietary interest in that money, has agreed that it should be permitted to be expended on legal expenses, either expenses so far incurred
all future legal expenses against the provision by the defendant solicitors of a letter explaining how much has been expended and on what. They're not obliged to produce the full fee note, which would contain privileged material, but I think they ought to provide material so that the claimant can be satisfied that the money has indeed been expended on genuine legal expenses. Right, now that covers what we have dealt with so far, correct? There is then the question of disclosure. Shall we take a short break?
Perhaps come back at...
Well, let's take 3:15. We'll come back at 2:45, okay? And we'll deal with that. Thank you.